Welcome again in my third lecture. Today I am going to discuss Robert Browning's dramatic monologue, The Last Ride Together. Whenever I commence to talk about Browning, I am reminded of Shelley's comment, like a poet hidden in the light of thought, singing hymns unbidden till the world is wrought. I wonder that these lines describe the literary position of Browning exactly. Only one thing accepted that he was not a singing poet like Shelley or Tennyson. Browning remained hidden in his lifetime. Thanks to T.S. Eliot and other critics of the 20th century that he is regarded as sometime a greater poet than Tennyson even. Browning was not a poet of society, rather he was made more universal than his fellow poet Tennyson. He does not believe that literature is the mirror of society. His motto lies in art for art's sake. His poetry seems to be a psychological response to his basic problems of life. Whenever he needs a solution, it comes to him from poetry. And perhaps this was the reason that his poems are soliloquies of a poet, with an aim of self-consolation. No doubt Shelley, Keats, Byron were the poets of love par excellence, but in none of them there is any felicity and robustness as we find in Browning. He regards love as a paramount power in spiritual development, and through it he develops a deep and profound philosophy of life grounded in optimism and faith. Compton Rickett has beautifully summed up Browning's position. He says that certain aspects of love have been more finely rendered by other poets, but in range of matter, Browning has no superior because his splendid vitality and cheerful hopefulness recoiled from them. It is strange to note that all the love poems of Browning, whether dealing with cases of successful love or failure in love, end on a note of optimism and triumph. Obscurity apart, Last Ride Together represents Browning's intertwined philosophy and ideology of love and optimism. Before starting this poem, let's clarify the love situation out of which the monologue grows. A lover proposes a lady whom he loves wholeheartedly, and after a pause he is plainly rejected by her. Now you will note that unlike the common lovers, Browning's lovers are bizarre in character, in thoughts. Just imagine what would have been done by an ordinary lover after being rejected in love proposal. He would start murmuring and complaining and alleging against his beloved, or he would go in deep depression, or the most common possibility, as you see in present perspective, is that he would throw acid upon her just to spoil what he has not got. But Browning's lover is quite calm and patient. He is an idealist and platonist in love. That's why there is no wounded pride, no anger, no arrogance. But on the contrary, his whole heart, not a part of it, sincerely blesses her. My whole heart rises up to bless your name in pride and thankfulness. Here he seems to reveal the secret philosophy of life, of love and life, that tat dukhi dukhitvam tat sukhi sukhitvam. And then he appeals her to have a ride with him for the last time. How strange this demand of him, you will see here. To his great joy, she gives her consent for that ride, which is not a ride, rather a last effort to get her. Have you noticed here, to get her? Now combine these words and you will find together. So you see, it is not only a last ride together, but also a last effort to get her. He says, The blood replenished me again. My last thought was not at least no when. I and my mistress side by side shall be together, breathe and write. So one day more am I defied. Who knows but the war may end tonight. The lover expresses his passion to immortalize the ecstasy of happiness, so he wishes to die here. Indian concept also refers to Ante Mateh Sa Gati. Shakespeare in Othello and Keats in Ode to a Nightingale have revealed the same psychological notion to die at that moment which we want to immortalize. Finally, with her consent, they commence their ride, and lover is experiencing the celestial bliss in the harmony between their love and natural phenomena. The agreement of his beloved seemed impossible like heaven's bond, but present moment provides blissful pleasure because of her company, though it is temporary. In fact, Browning believes in neither past nor future, neither remorse nor hope. He has a firm faith in present. He opines that if present is properly handled, future will automatically be perfect. So one must think of present, not of future, as it is said in the Gita. Gata sun na gata sunasch nanu shochit pandita. So it is of no use to regret or to feel sorry for the hopes which are not fulfilled. What is ended cannot be mended. And lover knows this fact. He says, had I said that, had I done this, so might I gain, so might I miss. He consoles himself with sanguine optimistic thought that at least she is riding by his side and he is realizing her company, relishing her company, which was quite impossible some moments ago. Though the notion of his failure in receiving the heartfelt love of his beloved pinches in his mind, yet he again gains strength by thinking, fail I alone? In words and deeds, why all men strive and who succeeds? You see here, he has squeezed success from failure, as it is said in a quote, you have heard it, don't be discouraged. It is often the last key in the bunch that opens the lock. He lays emphasis on the implementation of the thoughts into action without caring the result, as Lord Krishna also preaches in the Gita. Karmanyevadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. That's why he is not concerned with the consequences and seems satisfied with his efforts only. He utters, look at the end of work, contrast the petty done, the undone vast. This present of theirs with the hopeful past, I hoped she would love me, here we write. That's all for him. It is true that there is always wide disparity between conception and execution, between ambition and achievement. Man proposes and God disposes. Practical aspects of life is quite different with the imaginative aspect. You have heard this line, I think. Dai dai kyun karat hai, dai dai so kabool. The lover reflects over the lot of humanity in general when he utters, what hand and brain went ever paired? What heart ally conceived and dared? In his view, to try, to dare, anything has the greatest success in itself. That's why he feels proud of his courage to propose at least. Here I would like to mention T.S. Eliot's poem, The Love Song of Alfred J. Prufrock, who remains engaged in thinking, in planning to go and propose his beloved. He remains engaged in uttering these words, and instead there will be time to wonder, do I dare and do I dare? This is the reason that the optimistic lover of Browning proves his failure better than the neutrality of many others. He knows well that efforts are rarely rewarded. Just as a statesman's dedication and labor is rewarded merely with few lines as obituary notice in the newspaper. That's all for him, for his achievements. Great warriors and soldiers who sacrifice their lives for country are honored just by being buried in the Westminster Abbey. But he has got his concrete award of his efforts in his lifetime. It was his lifetime achievement in the form of that lady. Now it is quite conspicuous here that Browning believes in solid realities of life. He prefers practical things to idealism. While riding together, his lover imagines himself greater even than the poet, who aspires for something sublime that remains unapproachable throughout the life. He means to say here that the poet may be dexterous in expressing, in pouring out the thoughts and emotions of others, but remains deprived of experiencing, realizing those feelings practically. While the lover is more lucky to realize and relish those sentiments in the depth of his heart, he himself commits, than we who never have tuned a rhyme, sing, writing is a joy for me, and I write. Being an incorrigible optimist, the lover imagines his apparently trivial achievement 100 times better than a sculptor also, who spends his golden time in shaping a lifelike statue of Venus, that who is goddess of youth and beauty. But as everybody knows, that life is always greater than art. And the lover again proves himself to be more fortunate to have the living embodiment of beauty in the form of his beloved. So he needs not be gloomy and depressed. Then he refers to a musician who denotes his life in composing of musical tunes just for some words of appreciation from his near and dears. As you know, tastes in music are never constant. They remain always changing. Musicians cannot relish eternal fame, that's why. Thinking this, he again takes a sigh of relief, for that what he has achieved in rhythmical pace of writing, and feels himself again happier than the musician too. When I read these lines, who knows what is fit for us? Had fate proposed bliss here should sublimate my being, had I signed a bond. I am reminded of Dr. Faustus, who signed an agreement for 24 years with a devil, expecting the bright and renowned future for him. But what happened? This bond with fate proved disastrous and fatal for him. It shows that no one can anticipate what is good for us. So why should we not surrender ourselves to the will of God and relish what we have? As you have also heard this, Jahi Vidhi Rakhe Ram, Tahi Vidhi Rahiye. He further clarifies that if a man gets consummate happiness on this earth, heaven will have no charm for him. This is very notable point here. You will see here. To enjoy heavenly bliss, we should welcome failures and disappointments in this life. This bizarre lover shows his full-fledged faith in providence. Accept the failure and expects to get her love in heaven. It is really praiseworthy, and he manifests the most optimistic approach to the most pathetic and most pessimistic subject, that is death. He says, still one must lead some life beyond, have a bliss to die with, dim disgrace. This foot once planted on the goal, this glory garland round my soul. Now till here you can understand it well that writing is nothing but a symbol of faith, cooperation, adjustment and celestial bliss. The lover knows only this, that he has been riding with his lady and she has not asked him to stop it. That's all for him. It clearly indicates that they may ride on forever. In such a case, he will feel intense happiness and may experience the presence of heaven upon earth. For heaven is nothing but the perpetuation of everlasting happiness brought to him by this eternal ride. Thus, you have seen how wonderfully this poem imprints the sanguine note of optimism on the mind of the readers. That's all from my side. Hope you have enjoyed this elaboration, this explanation. Meet you in next lecture. Thank you.